How you are preparing for
this one?
This one. How you are preparing for the election proper? What are your programs to get back to the common house?
Well, thank you very much. In preparing for the election, I'm using my party platform, the PDP. The people of the Democratic Party in Delta State is very much on ground. We have our presence in every ward in this state. So we are using our presence in such wards to go around the state. We have put ourselves into teams, and each team will deal with each ward. It's more of a grassroots campaign, really, than type of campaign in case of newspapers or the media. Now, the way the INEC is such that, well, everybody has been clamoring for one man, one vote, whatever that means. But for anybody who wants to do an election now, must actually target the voting population. So our target is the voting population, which is more grassroots based. And we are doing it more through our party, rather than directly by myself.
Yeah, so by the time that judgment came, were you prepared for it? And what was your immediate reaction?
Yeah, I would say that judgment was very surprising to me, just as most Nigerians were very surprised, because we did not expect that the judgment would go the way it did. And today, our lawyers are still looking at the judgment. The PDP and lawyers tell me that they have issues with the judgment. Things have been done to deal with the issues.
I would like to ask about Chief Ike Clark's campaign on the pages of newspapers, since you mentioned pages of newspaper. What's the real issue or the real issues between you and Ike Clark? What has he got against you, and why can't you work as a family?
Well, I wish I had the opportunity to ask him what he has against me. I've asked him several times. He tells me I'm his son. Really, I'm yet to know exactly what the issues are.
The Excellency, there's a kind of confusion at the moment over the ruling of the appeal court. Did the appeal court rule order a rerun for a fresh election? Because we have some persons coming into the fray now and they want to contest elections. What exactly did the appeal court order?
I want to leave that to the lawyers. What I know is that my party has said, go and do elections again. So I want to reserve my comment on the appeal court ruling totally. My lawyers are looking at it, and I think they will come out fully because there are so many issues about that judgment that I believe that the press and the lawyers should actually look into. Why, for instance, will they say a certified photocopy of a document is not acceptable in court? And secondly, even the lawyers are saying they did not submit certified photocopy. You know, the document that was submitted at the lower court was not certified photocopy. So how did it come that at the appeal court level there was a certified photocopy? So then, like I said, there are issues, simple issues with judgment.
So then you're not bothered whether it is fresh election or
not? No, I'm not. I don't want to go into that debate. I want to focus myself on, I'm going for an election, and how do I deal with ensuring that I succeed in that election?
So what do you consider your strong points in going for this election?
My strong point is really that I was in office for about 3.5 years, and I was told to vacate that office. But in those 3.5 years, I think satisfactorily I have done some things that I believe that will qualify me for re-election. Even before those 3.5 years, I have been in government for 8 years, as Commissioner for Health for 4 years, and as Deputy Government for 4 years. And in those 8 years, I gathered a lot of experience about Delta. And then in these 3.5 years, I've tried to refocus Delta from a state where that is totally dependent on oil to move to a state that in the next few years can survive with or without oil. That is what the focus I tried to achieve in the 3.5 years. Yes, we are an oil producing state. We are a state in Niger Delta that has depended entirely on oil, just like the Nigerian government depends entirely on oil. Now, is it not possible that this oil will finish tomorrow? It's not possible that the price of the oil will drop, like we've seen. And so, in coming to government, I tried to, okay, what do we do to be able to move from that phase of depend totally on oil to where we do not depend, where we depend on other things? Because we have a lot of natural resources. Now, in doing so also, I believe that Delta State can be an economic hub of Nigeria. And so our focus has been that of moving to a stage of economic development where we are not just talking about an improved economy, but we are talking about a situation where a lot of our youth, our able-bodied young men, have the opportunity of being employed, either self-employment or being employed by companies. And so in doing that, in the last 3.5 years, I tried to put up a 3-point agenda of ensuring that we had peace and security, which I believe we achieved as much as possible, of ensuring that we try to improve on the infrastructure that is required for investors to come into Delta. Basically, infrastructure strategy, improving the infrastructure strategy, revolved around improving power, improving transportation, seaports, airports, of course, railway, and then also improving the ICT facilities in the state, try to improve on the urbanization of our towns in Delta. You must remember that Delta State has at least 14 urban centers, 14 towns that are urban centers. And that's where we are different from many other states. Many other states are just one town states, but Delta has about 14 towns that can actually qualify to be the capital of a state. And when you are developing one of the towns, you must also look at, whatever small measure, look at the other town. And so our second strategy is really that of infrastructure that will encourage investors. And of course, our third strategy is that of human capital development, in which we looked at the human being from the day of conception to the day the person enters the grave. Averagely saying, okay, this man lives above 70 years, or the woman lives a bit above 70 years. What can you do to influence that the child, the woman that gets pregnant today, that carries the child for 9 months? In that phase, we have said the quality of life of a child that is born depends on how well that child is taken care of in the womb of the woman. And many of our women do not have access to health care. They do not have the money to even access the health care. So what do we do? We said we offer free maternal services for every pregnant woman. And that was what we did in those people. That once you are pregnant, from the day of conception, the day deliver, if you don't have the money to pay, it's free in our health services. Even for those who have difficulty in getting pregnant, for women who have difficulty getting pregnant, if they do not have the money to go to hospital, they have free services in their hospitals. even up to surgery. I have this picture of a very big fibroid that was operated. A woman was operated on a big fibroid in afraid of child in her quest to get pregnant. So we have that program for both the unborn child and the woman that is pregnant, free of child. And thereafter, we have the child that is born for the first 5 years. We also have access to free healthcare because a lot of children have issues in their 5 years. So we have the free under five healthcare. Therefore, the other segment of society, if you cannot afford healthcare, you cannot afford to pay for the health services, periodically we have free healthcare for every segment of the society that cannot afford to pay. For right now, that program is going on. They are finishing its affair today. I think they are moving to tomorrow. So we have such health facilities. And even for the very high quality health facility, we also have our teaching hospital at the hospital. Then from 5 years, of course, we have the school age. Up to about 21 or 22. We have primary, we have the secondary, we have the tertiary. We have tried to design programs that will ensure that our children are in school from primary up to university. So from primary to secondary school, we do not have to pay anything, any fees or whatever form. Even the examination fee for WAEC and NECO, we pay for those for these children. And then after the, of course, to also improve on the quality of the secondary school teachers, we tried to redistribute the teachers. There were so many teachers in the upper schools. We moved a lot to the rural schools. And we found that the numbers were not even enough, so we had to employ teachers. We employed about 3,500 teachers and 1,500 non-teaching population in that particular period. Of course, after the secondary school age, we had university, we increased the bursary from 10,000 to 20,000 for every child in the university. And for those postgraduates, we improved on the scholarship scheme. And for every child, for every youth that has a first class university, the government took their education up anywhere in the world. We gave them automatic scholarship once they have a first class. So that's how we try to assist in the school age for the young population. And of course, after the school age, what really the problem is that of employment. Apart from the direct employment we gave as a government, I think in the period we employed over 14,000 people into various arms of government, we also had a microcredit scheme for those who have what we call the handwork. And apart from our microcredit scheme, we also have agriculture project, what we call the youth empowerment through agriculture. We selected youths, the first set was 18 by local government, into some guy farm where we trained them on various agricultural methods, ranging from fishing to crop and all that, and eventually set up the farm for them. In their local government councils, either as clusters or as individual farms. So many of them are into farming now. We've trained two sets that are into farming. So what we try to do is to ensure that our youths have one form of employment or the other. It is not yet enough because there are so many youths that are employed, but with the program we have started, we believe that in the next few years we should be able to deal with the payment of our youth. And of course, the next program that we are already designing is that of social welfare for those who are retired, 70 and that one is the government. So we try to do that with our human capital development program. And I believe that with all this, we have something to market. I will go back to campaign.
Sir.